guys, welcome to my channel, and for today's video, as you will have seen the title, it is a wedding planning video. So how to plan a wedding, some great tips and tricks that I have for you to hopefully help you out. Of course, it is wedding time and wedding season. Of course, people are getting engaged as well at this time. So I think if you're starting to plan a wedding, or you're even in the last couple months of preparation before your wedding, my goal is to give you a lot of tips and advice. Based on having the experience of doing this. So to get started, what I wanted to share with you is my tools that I use for planning the wedding. So if you're planning a wedding on your own and you're not having a wedding planner or a wedding coordinator and you're wanting to do it all by yourself, for me, I love planning things and planning parties or events. And this just kind of was like another piece that I could plan and like do something fun with. So I was excited to plan the wedding because I knew my organizational skills would kick in and I could use all of my day planners and all of my journals. I was told, and I know it did work, my process and my method and my tools did work because I had so many people telling me on the wedding day and after the wedding, oh my gosh, this wedding was so organized, like you were so organized, and you know, all of my vendors told me how organized I was and how that was so helpful and so great. So I definitely think I have some great tips for you. But to get started, what I think everybody needs is a wedding planning binder. Before I created my own binder and my own system, I had went and bought a wedding planner binder, such as this one. This one was great because it is the ultimate wedding planning book. It does have in here, it's like a book style, right? So it has ideas, actually has like a budget analysis, for example. This stuff I'm going to show you in more detail. In my blog post, I will have something that's coordinating to kind of help you out and show you of what a good way to do things and how to organize. The biggest thing I didn't like about this book is it's, you know, it's like a book, right? It's not a binder. So it has a lot of great things. And of course, in the back here, it has a little opening latch here, and then it's got some folders. So you can kind of organize things that you might get. It is very compact, if you're looking for something like that. It's more of a book. This is definitely a good keepsake. But for somebody who's planning this themselves and not using a wedding coordinator, this book isn't the best. Because yes, you can file things in the back, but sometimes it's nice just to have your binder where you can put things in, take them out. When you want to put something that specifically is having to do with your flowers, you can't insert it into the flower section. And that was something that really bugged me. So I had gone out and bought the binder style. It's another ultimate wedding planning workbook. I purchased them at Chapters or Indigo. So it was hard for me to carry around. So then I found that to be an issue for when I'm planning. So then I switched over into creating my own. Take things, elements out of this one, elements out of the other one I had bought, and kind of put them together and created my own binder that worked for me. The next tool that I would suggest is to have a wedding planning dedicated notebook. So I use this small little notebook. I got this from Walmart. It's a little cupcake notebook. It's nothing crazy. Originally I had gotten this because this was my original colors I wanted in my wedding, which was like the pink and the purple and blue, which I'm sure you've seen, and you'll see in a lot of the things I've made. That was my original thoughts, and then it completely changed. At the end of the video, I will show you some photos from the wedding to kind of show you decor that I did. All of the decor was done by myself, all hand done. So everything you'll see was done by myself. And I had a bit of help from my sister. We did our own bouquets, we did everything. And it was just a way to save on costs. You can still be on a budget and you can still save costs, but make your wedding look amazing. It came to decor and it came to all those little things. Definitely didn't spend a lot, and everyone loved it. Everyone kept complimenting on the decor, but I spent so much time working on it over the months leading up to the wedding. So I will tell you more about that stuff. But yeah, so you do want a good wedding notebook. This one I went through really quickly, and I'm going to pick out things from inside. That's why they're labeled here, because I want to share things with you that are helpful. And then I eventually moved to this taller notebook because I needed more space to draw things and whatnot. So the reason why I'd say you need a notebook is keep the notebook in your purse. You don't need to carry your wedding binder around per se. Keep your wedding notebook And always your day planner, because you always are booking things in for appointments to see people or whatever it is, or you're planning things out, a time frame anyway. But notebook, this is great because if you're at even work and you're on your lunch break and you have spare time and you're working on wedding stuff and you are searching stuff and you find these awesome sites and you're like, I have to remember to go back to these, you write them in your notebook. My notebook has anything and everything. It's not specifically organized into sections. I just would write it in here and then refer back. So that's what I use. I use notebooks, filled as much as I can in them. And they're great tools. If, like I had said, I was transitioning and I wanted to create my own binder. So I did just that. I created my own wedding planning binder. So I just went and got these from Staples. Office Depot, all those places, they have them. And I got really pretty. I've got three of these binders because I used two for myself. One was for my planning. One was for all of my receipts and things I had paid for, just a separate one because there was a lot. And then one was for my best friend's wedding because I helped planning a lot of stuff. So I kept track of everything. But I just got these beautiful binders. They're really great. They're not huge, so they're easy to slip into a bag. And they're really beautiful. And I mean, I think they're all of $3 or $4. So you definitely need your binder. Another thing I would suggest, and some of the wedding planning binders that you purchase in store will come with these, a business card binder holder. So this holds all business cards. So these are business cards from people you're going to meet. If you go to a bridal show, if you go to any meetings for vendors or photographers or whatnot, you're going to keep all their business cards in there because you will need them. You're going to need to find them. So that was the wedding planning binder that I specifically used. And then, yes, I had my notebooks, and you're going to be like, wow, she had a lot of stuff. But what I did is I took all of my notebooks, all of my things in my binder, because I use the binder to house things, and I had this wonderful book that I found. So this is another type of notebook. Now, this was where I got really nitty-gritty organized. And I would say this is like a project management book. So for each project, whether that was flowers or cake or whatever, I then had my lists inside of what needed to be done and who I spoke to, and it was my method of keeping track. The book is a nice hardcover book, also got from Staples, and I absolutely love this book. This was probably one of my favorite notebooks that I've ever gotten. And inside, I kept everything really organized. So I started off, and I'll show you guys this when I flip you around. I started off with creating a timeline. I'm gonna see if you can kind of see. It's pretty, might be tough. But I started off with a timeline at the very beginning for when I wanted to get things done, and how it needed to look for the whole 2 years. So I basically did keep track of everything I needed to get done. And then what I did is create these little tabs here of specific places. So, you know, it might be one that's photographer, one is for cake shops, great stores for the bachelor party, ideas, and I've put everything in here. So I've got things like sample cards for examples of things I've liked. What else do I got in here? You know, I'll try to put pictures and stuff like that. You know, if I got something from a vendor at a bridal fair thing, I put it in there. So the last couple tools that I wanted to show you are the bride's instruction manual. This one, again, I had got from Chapters Indigo. Now, this one is a guide to bridal essentials. The author is, oh my gosh, let's see. By Carrie Denny. So I'll have her information below for you guys. It's an instruction manual. It says how to survive and possibly even enjoy the biggest day of your life. That is one thing that I loved for tips, because you don't realize it until the day comes, but it's very difficult to enjoy your day. And you try to remind yourself at different points in the day, oh yes, take this in. Or you try to remind yourself to enjoy that moment, but it's very difficult because you're so worried about everything running smoothly. And is this person doing what I've asked them to do? You know, is this person doing their job? And you're just so busy trying to keep everyone else having a good time and having fun that you forget to have fun sometimes yourself. So definitely read manuals like this of how to be calm and how to just like let the day happen. If things don't work out, they don't work out. Unless it's a big thing and you know you're like, I need this to happen at my wedding, you know, make sure you have a few people in charge of making sure that happens, but the rest of it, it won't matter. Half the people don't even know if something's going wrong, so it's kind of good actually. But yeah, this manual is really great. Like that, it's just got some really great illustrations, and they're just really cute. Very last tool that I found extremely useful is the Bride's Book of Lists. So this one is by Amy Niebens, and I will also have her info below. And as well, again, all this stuff will be on the coordinating blog post, so you can see it all. What does it look like? Who is it by? And then an in-depth look. So the blog post is going to be a really big blog post, but it's going to have a lot of things that you're going to really enjoy. So yeah. But yeah, this one, the Book of List, this one literally has lists for everything. Your ceremony, your reception, the stationery, and you just check off your list. So for example, let's see if we can get you guys to see that. So this was for the reception. It gives you lists and you just check them off as you go. And this is just things like, did I make appointments to meet with people? Did I select my menu? And I would just check things off as they would happen, just to make sure I had everything once again. And this was just my way of not having to create a to-do list and then check everything off. I just use this book because you'll find you don't want to write out a to-do list because you don't have time. You have time to check one off. So this was a great little tool as well. So those are all the tools I had. The biggest piece of advice I would say is do your research on what are you thinking of for your colors and your theme and all that kind of stuff. Get your idea of what you like, because when you have your idea of what you like, it makes the whole process way simpler because you have that idea in mind. So some things that I did, and it depends, if you have a color printer or whatnot, it's helpful. And I did attach these into my wedding planning binder eventually. So what I would do is I'd go on Pinterest, I'd go on where I just Google things, I'd look for lookbooks and ideas, and I literally just would print off, you know, photo collages of ideas that I liked. So for example, this was when I was into the purple theme and I really was into like wanting purple and blue and whatnot. So you'll see here, there's just some decor ideas that I really liked and just some ideas for decor. Then when I go to this one here, so again, just more of like themed pictures, decor ideas. I was just trying to get an idea of what kind of style I liked. Did I like something modern or did I like something that was maybe more vintage? What colors did I like? And at that time, like I said, I was really into like the blues and the purples and whatnot. And my mind did change. I changed my mind probably 3 times until I had it right. So yeah, there again is some photos. So once I printed off my photos and I had pages of these things, I created a storyboard. So again, with my creative side, these are things I like doing. So what you could do next is once you've got your pictures and you've seen what you like, create your storyboard. So get a big piece of poster board. And I wish I still kept mine because I didn't keep it because it would have been great to show you guys. But it's just a big poster board. Glue on there all the things that you want to do and have on there, you know, all the things you like. It doesn't matter if you've picked your color scheme quite yet, but the things you like, if you want a wishing tree or what kind of centerpieces do you like, put them all on there. Have your organization of it so that it's like, this is the cake section, this is how I want things to look for chairs or whatever, and just have a big poster board. And then you have that as your reminder, okay, well, this is the idea I'm going for. So then once you have your idea and you've created your storyboard, you now kind of have a direction of what am I looking for. Other things that I would say, once you do have your core planning and you've done your storyboard, you can then go into making your wedding book, making your wedding planning binder, and like start really brainstorming. And you do have to brainstorm, and that's why I loved the notebook part of it, because I would just brainstorm like crazy of shops that I was interested in. Gifts, if I felt like looking at gifts one day for people, you know, that's what it was all about. So I will be taking you into a look at the wedding planning process and what I did and how I stayed organized. I'm going to flip you guys around. This is going to be a wedding planning series because I don't want to take, you know, 30 or more minutes telling you guys about some great tips. So I'm going to do it in separate video sections. Today's video, of course, though, is going to be looking at those tools to use. And then I'm going to do another video that will be sort of extra tips and advice. And then another video will be on planning your bachelorette bachelor party, because that is a whole other section that takes a lot of time. But yeah, so I'm going to flip you guys around and take you for a look inside of the tools, so you can get a better look at like how did I organize this and how did I make this all work. And yeah, I hope you guys enjoy. If you have questions after, feel free to leave comments on the comment section. I can help you as best as I can if you want to know where I got something or whatnot. I will do my best, of course, have all these tools and stuff listed as well as in the blog post. But yeah, so I'll see you guys after I show you inside. Okay guys, so here is a look at the Ultimate Wedding Planning Workbook and Organizer. So this is the one I had purchased. And this one I'm just going to show you of what it comes with so you can get a better idea of what exactly it comes with. And you might notice, you'll see when I show you my wedding binder that I created, you'll see why I didn't stick with this guy. So of course it is hardcover. It is not overly huge. It's not a binder style at all. It's just like a book style. Basically the first pages, they have kind of like a lookbook. So I guess it's supposed to be to give you inspiration, and ideas, basically what it says here. The problem is that most of this inspiration and these ideas are old photos. And I would say from, you know, probably the year 2000 all the way to 2000 and maybe 11, I would say, or 12. And like the styles are just not quite on point as they are today. So that's one thing, is that, you know, unless they're updating these photos, it's kind of out of style. You know, books, I guess. But it does have good ideas for flowers, you know, veil lengths and whatnot. Just kind of things to think about, I would say. Get to the front here. Got a little, it has a little place, of course, for where you can put, you know, who you're marrying. Very next part here, which I was, of course, using. It has here the proposal. So you can actually, you know, write out how he proposed, and have notes and stuff. And this I had wrote out right away, pretty much as soon as I got home. And I had that on my own kind of sheets. And then I wrote it in my own journal. And then I transcribed it into here because I knew I was going to be keeping this wedding planning binder. And just like who you told and whatnot. And people's reactions. And then it goes into the checklist. So the checklist is pretty large. It goes on these two pages. It has everything from what you should be doing 9 months ahead of time all the way into the early months to come, those last minute things. This was extremely helpful, hard when you're planning a wedding a year in advance. Some of these things, if you're planning an out-of-town wedding, they don't work in the timeline. So that's why I had to create my own binder, because some of these things, I couldn't do them 9 months or earlier. I needed to do them now. So that was one thing and a reason why I did have to adjust, but I utilized the things on the list in my own binder. And it goes all the way down to day of planning. So what you need on the wedding day. Your budget analysis. So this is where you can break down. If you are on a strict budget, you have to know what all am I going to need? Because it's not like it's, you know, a few things. It's, you do need to have a lot of things. And this does have almost that list of items of things that you might want to have or might not. Very helpful for your budget. And then it does actually have a budget breakdown in here, which is very useful if you want to use it. For us, I won't lie, we didn't really create a budget for ourselves. We knew what we wanted to spend in the range of. We had a price kind of cap that we were like, okay, we shouldn't spend more than this because that's kind of ridiculous. So we didn't break things down necessarily like, oh, this is what I have for flowers. This is what I have. I didn't quite do that. And we did have the luxury of not having to do that, which was great, but there are people that need to. So this is a great tool because you can write out if your wedding plan is that your budget is $20,000 or even $10,000, you can plan out what you want to spend your money on, what you don't. I still did that. But kind of in my own way, I knew that I just was able to kind of keep track of it mentally. I don't know how I was able to, but I really was. So this portion didn't really get used as much inside of this binder. I wrote things out separately. And I think it was more because this is a great sheet. You could, as a wedding planner, you could, you know, photocopy this, or, you know, take some samples of this, create it in your own template and use it for your clients. Then it goes into your vendor payment tracking chart. This also is very useful, because as you pay people, you know, it's got their info, you put when you did the contract and the total cost, when you did a deposit, and then when you did your final payment. For me, again, I kept track sort of in my notebooks, as well as in my day planners, because I keep those with me, as you'll know that I do have a lot of day planners. So I kept track of that stuff myself, and I had a full binder dedicated to payments because I wanted to keep track of everything. So I didn't necessarily want to write it out. There's not enough space sometimes, especially if you've got multiple payments or things like that. It just doesn't quite work.
All right, guys, so I'm going to move on from the wedding planning workbook onto the wedding planning binder that I created. I wanted to move on from the workbook because I think you probably got a general sense of what it is that's in there, and I wanted to get into the nitty-gritty of what you need for your planning. So again, I had got these binders from Staples. I'm going to go right into it, jump right into it. It has a nice little flap here, which is where I kept different ideas. So for example, this is what I did for my bridesmaids' gifts. I did a printout at bridal party gifts. So things that I either had purchased, things I had made, other things that I got, other things I had made again, just ideas and whatnot of what I wanted to give them. So when I always had that in my binder. The other things I usually kept at the front of my binder here were emails. Different emails is typically what I've kept in here. Moving on to here, so I did have a plastic pouch. This was for anything like I did keep any cash or anything that I needed in here, any coupons, etc. In my front first page, I did keep my group roster, which was we had a wedding that was out of town, so I had to have our group roster on file, and that was basically everyone that booked with us. For our bachelor and bachelorette parties, I had made or got made from Zazzle.com. So as you can see, it says last fling before the ring, and it's just like a Vegas theme because our trip was in Vegas, and then just a playing card that says the details. So really cute card. The boys, I got the ones done for the boys as well. The next part here in this next section, the first section, is our simplified budget planning. So I had different Excel spreadsheets that I made for our venues. So I did have some that were for different venues that we looked at. We had two, narrowed down two venues that we had been interested in, and then broke them down by price and what it would cost. And we ended up determining that we wanted more people to come to our wedding than less, so we actually went with a different place. So we had our wedding at the Grand Rockies Resort, which was in Canmore, Alberta, in the Rocky Mountains. It was beautiful. Basically, this I just created myself. So here I just did an Excel spreadsheet. It has which one it was. This was the simplified budget. So I had the food and beverage estimates. We had two types of dinner buffets. So they had the cost. We knew we wanted red and white wine. A midnight snack, and then we just basically went on with the totals there. So I just priced it out. I did the number of people, the price, the subtotal, plus the gratuity, the GST, and then your total cost. And then basically what it would be for having a boutique style or habitat buffet, which was just two different styles of buffets, one with more food, one with less. The bottom here is venue, so venue rentals. So this was all basically just for the venue itself. So we knew that we needed to rent the ballroom for the night before to set up, as well as the day of and the ceremony space. There are fees you must pay since you are playing music, and then we needed a microphone speaker rental. And of course, again, I just did number of people, don't have to worry about that. So just the overall price plus GST, and then total meal charges plus the total other charges, and then worked out an estimate of what we thought it would be. Now, this did not include our price for our alcohol, because we did, of course, have a $3 bar. That wasn't included in this. This is just sort of a basic upfront cost. So I did a couple of these, and I worked them out based on 100 people for guests and 120 people as guests. And then this was my comparison hotel, and I did the exact same thing. So this one had a three-course dinner. There was a midnight snack. You had your white, your red, your champagne toast, a bunch of different rental fees. And yeah, as you can see, they're pretty close in cost, but we wanted a little bit more people. So I did that myself, creating that budget. And all on Excel spreadsheet. That was based on where we were going to pick our final place that we wanted to have it at. Wedding cost. So this was something that our place did provide an example of, and I thought, okay, this is a great thing to have. So most places charge on top of whatever your costs are. They charge gratuity. So make sure you're keeping that in mind. For us, it was 18% gratuity charge. So I had to keep that in mind when estimating how much our costs were going to be. So in here, I broke it down to how much was our room rental going to be, so our ballroom and our ceremony space, made sure to include tax, and then what was that total, and then any per person cost, you could put that if you wanted to. The basic dinner, how much that was, including cocktails, if we averaged about $5 each, plus your gratuity, wine for dinner, how many bottles, etc. And then the total estimated price per guest for dinner. So, and that was based on dinner, you're having one cocktail and a half a bottle of wine. So, and they estimated the price for, per person, I guess, which it was a little higher because most people didn't have just one cocktail, of course. So it was probably worked out to about $110, $115 per person. And then basically any add-ons, there was in our resort a cake cutting fee. So make sure you check that out. What we did is we didn't have our cake cut. We had people come up and if they wanted a piece of cake, they could cut it themselves. Cupcakes actually end up being more expensive, so just keep that in mind. People think cupcakes are going to be cheaper. They're actually not. They're probably a little bit more expensive, so just keep that in mind. And make sure that as well, if you're at a place that you need a microphone and speaker, make sure you do see if the venue has one, or if you need a slideshow type of thing, like a little projector, make sure they have that as well in case you're doing any kind of slideshows and whatnot, because sometimes your DJ might not have those. My next section here was literally jot notes of people I was interested in. So I didn't have it organized in any particular way. Basically, if I found a videographer, what I did was go through all the people and then basically email them, find out their info and what they cost, and then either crossed them out if I didn't want them, moved on to the next one. Photo booths, I did research into photo booths and where I wanted, how much it was going to cost me, what it all included. And then again, this is all kind of videographers. Then it went onto websites. So I did my own flowers. I didn't have any real flowers. I did faux flowers for the bouquets and we made them ourselves and they looked amazing. People might be like, what? But they were amazing. They actually turned out really nice. I think if you have a creative eye to do that kind of stuff, then why not? Why do you need real flowers? You're going to spend how much on real flowers? It's just not worth it, in my opinion, spending $2,000 on flowers. I think in total, I probably spent maybe $200 or $300 on flowers, which was definitely a huge difference. I had a more of a rustic theme, so I had a lot of things that I didn't need to worry about that didn't need flowers. But I did keep track here if there was flowers online, websites, if I was doing fake or silk arrangements, other flower shops that were in town. This is when I was doing the research. And then I have on here marriage license, because that's something you're going to need to make sure that you do have is your marriage license. I think people forget about that sometimes. This part I did spas and salons. So again, I just researched in that area all the different spa and salons, what they included for bridal packages. And then I just wrote down the best ones that there were and then just tried to figure out which ones I was interested in after calling and contacting them. Next, so I had a bunch of different emails. So I have emails from our pastor in this specific section. Want to hear. So music. So when I was looking at music, I wanted to have somebody live outdoor playing string. We had a violin, we had a cello. So yeah, so basically I had found these people again in Canmore region. So we had them and they were really easy. You just basically tell them what you're looking for and they just showed up and we had someone pay them and that was it. And they left. So that was really cool. That also is the same thing. Wedding plan. What I did is I actually had my bridesmaids all over together and I was again extremely organized. So what I did was invited all my bridesmaids over for a meeting. And basically with that, what I did was create a wedding plan so that they knew what was happening. So basically the wedding plan looked like this. Here's our wedding plan. When is the date? Where is our ceremony and reception? When you need to be there. So I wanted all the girls and guys pretty much to be there on the day before so that we could have a girls' day, make some bouquets if needed, and have our rehearsal and rehearsal dinner. So then I also gave them the year plan. Because we had a bachelorette party going on, we were going to have a shower, we were going to have all these things happening. I wanted them to know ahead of time so that they could plan out their financing and so that they would be able to make it to everything. So basically, 1 year in advance, I had sent out our save the date so that people could make the plan, see that we're going to be in Canmore, which was, a pretty good drive for most people, so that they could start thinking about taking time off. I basically discussed in here the room so that the night before that they would be able to stay with me. And then the night of the wedding, they would have to book their own room. So they really only had to pay for one room. A year before, we went bridesmaid dress shopping where we were going to decide on that date for the bridesmaid dress shopping. And we did go, and then we basically ordered our dresses around December. So September, we sent out our A-list invitations, and we asked those people to RSVP by December. And basically what we did with our A-list invitations is those were the people we really, really wanted to come. And then if they couldn't come, we sent out our B-list invitations. October, I did put Will Taylor addresses, but we didn't order them that soon. So that wasn't anything to worry about. January, again, yes, we did order our bridesmaid dresses. May, we went for the bachelorette party and the bachelor party. So that day we decide on prices and what our plan was and what everyone could afford. And then we put when I wanted my bridal shower and then the actual wedding. So I had a great list of plan. And then I also had the bachelorette party plan. So where it was going to be and then different discussion items, our boyfriend's coming, rooms, when are we going to book, who can come, the budget, activity ideas, flight and hotel plan, and then what do people want to do while we're there. So I had a pretty good organized look at what we're going to be doing. And then I won't show you guys that, but I just had everyone's contact information for the bridal party so that they could all have it. All right, in this next section here, I have my venue, and basically when it comes to my venue, I had taken some photos when I was at the venue and also got some photos from online of basically what there was to work with. Because when you're planning, you want to plan your decor out or you want to visualize how you want your wedding to look, it is very helpful to have photos because then you can kind of figure out how you want your room to look. So this first photo here was the main ballroom that we had. Basically, I used this photo to figure out where I was going to have our head table. It did come quite a bit more this way. It was a huge room. This is just from probably about half of the room. And I knew that I was going to have my head table along this section here, my cake table and whatnot, and then everyone would come back from there. And then the bottom photo here, this was outdoors. Our ceremony was outside. So as you can see there, this is the way that they set up the chairs, where you could have, you guys walking down the aisle kind of thing, and you got the Three Sisters Mountains in the background. Very beautiful. I ended up walking from behind the building, so my husband was facing this way, and he didn't see me until I literally got there. So I walked all the way down this pathway, which was literally a dream of mine to be able to do that. I had just visualized myself walking down this pathway, and it turned out exactly how I planned. So I had the musical instruments over here, so they kind of blocked off this little building here. But otherwise, I had all my chairs and everything set up here, and then basically the hotel ran back here. So most of us had rooms right off of this courtyard. So that's what I used to help me plan and how I wanted to decorate. Again, I had some more photos. This is more of the back end of the room. And just like some beautiful chandeliers. So I just wanted to figure out how I was going to coordinate this all together. Okay, so then I did some drawing out. So when it comes to planning out how you want things to look, I'm a very visual person. So I took the room space, drew basically a rectangle, and planned out where I wanted things. So I knew that if this was where those windows were, I knew I wanted my head table there. And then I knew I wanted other tables. So I wanted to figure out how did I want my centerpieces to look. So originally my plan was to have smaller centerpieces with my name or table cards and then like kind of like those little tree branches hanging with little candles. I was pretty close on. And then I had my gift table originally on this side, and then I moved that to the cake table because there just wasn't enough space. The guest book table, I wanted a little bit of flowers and whatnot. The chalkboard with chalkboard and some sort of cork board with all of the table chart, and then the guest book, which was a tree and everyone did their fingerprint. And then, of course, I had here a cake example. So things changed over time. And I basically tried to figure out how many tables I need and just like room decorations, what I was going to do. The venue actually did give me a printout of what the room dimensions were. So I recommend that if you can get one, it's very helpful in your planning, especially again, if you're planning this by yourself. So I got the room dimensions. This was the entrance door. So I did put over here my guest table right before people came in. Only thing I found is that it was a bit of a lineup for people coming into the venue because they were trying to do the thumbprint, and that does take more time. So I do suggest if you like the thumbprint idea, have that as an art piece inside your room so anyone can just go up whenever they want. Keep your guest book very simple. If you can do your guest book at just the ceremony, I would say do that and reduce the amount of time of people just standing by the door because that took up a lot of time. I had the head table here. I had my cake table here. This was where we had, people kind of speaking, I guess. So like our MC and whatnot in this location. This is another door here, but this was basically where our bar was set up. And whatnot. And then all the tables expanded back to here. My DJ booth was here, dance floor here, and then gift table was here, all bar was here. So ended up working out pretty nicely. And this one too, again, same thing. I just kind of like broke it down. This is upside down, of course, but I put the tables in. I just had as many as I possibly could just to plan it out. So I think the more the better. My next section is sort of like my inventory. So every time I bought something, I put it in a box in my basement. And then eventually I had to bring it all up and account for what I had. So I knew I was doing a rose petal aisleway. So I did a design down the aisleway with rose petals. So I bought faux rose petals, all from online stores. They were really cheap. That's the way to do it. I would not recommend getting them from Michaels or anywhere where they're going to cost you like $20 or $30 per package. That is ridiculous when you can go online and get 200 petals for $5. So buy them wholesale, buy them bulk. So I would just keep track and inventory of what I had and saw what else I needed to have. Because it was hard sometimes, so you didn't want to pull it all out, but you wanted to have an idea of what you needed. So just an inventory of things that I have. For example, two tall branches, two tall vases for the ceremony. Actually those two tall vases I'll show you because I'm in my living room now. These two tall vases were used for my ceremony. Those are faux flowers in there, which match the colors that I had with the tall branches minus the stars, but I had those for my ceremony and those were awesome. And I think they looked really great. So again, I just went through everything that I had. So I had quite a bit of stuff. Again, a lot of stuff. More stuff. This is all gifts, etc. I had a ton of stuff. So, and then I would just check off, like, here's some other things I added to my list. Like, do I have wedding shoes, a wedding band, veil, da 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 da. And I checked, marked it off when I had it. I had gifts for the wedding weekend. So bridesmaids, gifts, groomsmen gifts. For the bridesmaids gifts, we did a bridesmaid box. So it was a custom box. I got the boxes. They were, I think, 10 for $5 at Michael's. I put a mini champagne in there, a custom glass, which I painted, and then a bracelet that was kind of like a Pandora style, a pair of diamond earrings, a nail polish that was sparkly because that was our theme. And what else? I think that's it. Yeah. And then the groomsmen, they got these mini mason jar shot glasses, which were really cute, and then custom beer glasses that had their name, and then just said, they're like beer, big tall beer glasses, really cute. Also ordered online on Etsy, so that was a great spot to get stuff. Next section here, I probably didn't have anything. This section here is where I kept photography stuff. So this is another really important part. So this was basically what our photographer gave us. This was important to me because I wanted to remember what does her package include. And then I have her info and stuff on here. And then also what she has for prints and products. So I wanted to always have this so that I want, if I want to go back and get stuff, because honestly, I've got a wedding album. I've got printed off photos that I did myself, but I don't have any big style of photos. So that's something I need to do. So this is where I can go back and see how much those cost. Photography. So this came out of a wedding workbook. So this was types of photos to get, what you're going to want. samples of it all. Very important stuff, because you want to remember that, you know, you're not going to have time to think about the types of photos you want. So just make sure that you have a list and send it to your photographer. So this little wedding book had a great list of photographs. So pre-ceremony photographs, and then we've got over here, we've got ceremony photographs, just some other ones, your post-ceremony photographs, that kind of stuff. So lots of ideas. Make sure you make a list. If you have a photo list, print those out for yourself so you know what you want and take them with you. And that way you can show your photographer what you're thinking for a creative background. This section was my Vegas. So I was trying to keep track of people who were planning to come to Vegas for the Bachelor Bachelorette party. This was keeping track of who RSVP'd for the wedding. So I did keep a little tally. And then who I had from verbal RSVPs versus actual sent in. Table names. So basically what we did is we had little table cards which had names of cars. My husband's very much into car brands, so we had like Mercedes or Lamborghini, and those were the table names, and I had them on I just made them like really creative and pretty. And so I just matched who I wanted to be sitting at what table so that I could plan that out for my table chart. Again, I was planning out my tables, and that kind of stuff changes as people come in or out. Again, more table planning. It takes a lot to figure out how many tables you have and how many people are coming or not coming. This section was a stationery checklist. So this just says, you know, did you have your invitations, envelopes? Do you have all that stuff, the save the dates, etc.? Pew cards, seating place cards, maps, etc., programs, very important things. A sample ceremony program, very important to have this. This was in, again, a wedding workbook. You can Google this stuff online as well. I did pretty much that. I Googled stuff online as well as had used these sample programs. Because sometimes it's confusing. You're like, how do I lay this out? I made all of my programs myself, matched them as best as I could to the wedding invitations, which I did purchase. But I wanted to do the programs myself because people don't even keep them anyway. So I didn't care too much about them. Just wanted them to look pretty. So this is kind of just an idea of like how it all should work. Music. This was probably another really big thing. So because we had ceremony music, I was trying to figure out what I wanted in what order. So basically what you have to do is figure out music that you like and coordinate it to when your grandparents are walking in, when the guests are walking in, when you're walking in, when the bridesmaids or the groomsmen are walking in. You got to coordinate it all and create yourself a playlist so you can hear it and figure out the time frames of each of that. So then you know how fast you can either walk or whatever. And you just coordinate, if you're having live music, you coordinate that with your live music people for the timing of things, what they need to look for, so that they see, oh, hey, that's the last bridesmaid, now I know I should start our next song, or that's the last grandparent, now I know what to start. So music can be very important, especially if you can't hear it. For us, it was difficult to hear until you pretty much came to a certain point in the ceremony location. So that was a little bit tougher. Again, the reception music. This, again, is just different things to consider. I had a great list of music I wanted played by our DJ. Make sure your DJ has experience. Make sure that when you talk to him that he's got a backup plan if he cannot access the music that you've picked, because that was our problem. He couldn't access the music we picked for first dances, etc., and was playing music that was not our first dance. That was pretty devastating, so make sure you have that planned out. Flowers, again, I did all fake, but this is a great example of, you know, where to have them. Do you want to have them in your aisle pews? For me, I didn't have any flowers in the aisle. I only had my two tall vases at the end of the aisle where I would be walking through and standing by. And then I had a decor table which had my guest book and some photos of people who've passed on who we wanted to kind of be a part of the day. Okay, so this is just more of that. Gifts, this is a great other thing that came from a wedding book. It had gift ideas, so I just use these as great ideas. Parties, the different types of parties to have, another great thing for ideas. Your wedding party responsibilities. If you could send this to your wedding party, I would say do it, because that's one thing I never did. And I felt like my wedding party was like lost puppies. They didn't know what to do. They expected me to tell them what to do, which I don't think that I should have to. As a bridesmaid or maid of honor, it is your job. And I'm going to tell you all out there, it is your job that if your bride is, you know, coming up to the aisle, you are supposed to fix her dress, for example. When she's going to take photos, you fix her dress. You adjust her dress. If something doesn't look right, fix her hair. That is your job. That is your responsibility. And make sure that as a bride, that you send that responsibility out to your bridal party so that they know the day of that it is about you and you do need their help, because you can't do it all by yourself. And this just goes into the responsibilities. So maid of honor, for example, helps the bride select the attire, plans the bridal shower, arrives at the dressing site 2 hours before the ceremony, arranges the bride's veil and train before the processional and the recessional at the beginning and at the end, hold the bride's bouquet at the groom's ring when you do the exchanges. Keep bride on schedule. I will say I did not find that I had my bridal party helping me with keeping things on schedule. It was sort of like me having to run around, and I even gave people the schedules and I expected that they would help out with that. So I think it's very important that you again reiterate to your bridal party what they need to be doing so that it's done properly and on time and that they're helping you, because if no one's helping you and everyone's relying on you to make the decisions and the calls, that's a little stressful. So I found that like I never got to enjoy my day because it was just too much of me having to do a bunch of things that I shouldn't have had to do. So make sure that everyone in your bridal party, both the guys and the girls, have a good idea of what the heck they need to be doing, along with your MC. Make sure that they have all the details. Make sure you have friends and family that have the details so they can help you out as much as possible so that you're not worrying, because you shouldn't have to worry. Again, other more wedding party responsibilities, your bride's mother, ushers. I found the moms were great in terms of trying to, you know, help out a bit. Pretty much the typical things would be in here. Who pays for what? This is a great thing. If you're wondering, okay, the bride's family pays for this, groom's family pays for this. For us, we paid for our own wedding ourselves, which was important to us because we wanted to make our own decisions and we didn't want people who were paying for it to be making the decisions for us. So if you're getting your parent to pay for parts of the wedding, believe me, you are going to have to allow and accept that they are going to want to have their opinions and suggestions for things, and you're probably going to have to accept them. So this kind of just gives you a list of those. Wedding formations. This is also so important. I can't tell you where you want your people to stand. I prefer not having everyone's back to the audience because they're getting photos taken. It just doesn't make sense. This is a way of how you're going to have them walking down the aisle. And just like processional, recessional, very different style. A receiving line if you're having one, your head table, the parents' table. Just some ideas of what you can do. Things to bring to your rehearsal. So this was a great list. If you have announcements or gifts, again, you know, try to plan this out as much as you can in terms of what you're going to be doing. Things to bring to the ceremony. So this is a bride's list of things to bring to the ceremony. Very important. This is not the bride's duty to be looking at this stuff. You should be expecting your bridal party to be doing this. So it's their job to research what they're supposed to do being a part of a bridal party. Same with the groom's list. That is in charge of, I would say, probably your best man, some of your groomsmen. Again, these are things that you shouldn't have to tell your bridal party. I would, just so that they're aware of what they need to be doing, but it is also their job to Google search or get a book that's how to be, you know, in a wedding, or what's the responsibility of a bridesmaid or whatever. So that's pretty much the gist of the wedding binder. How is the most important thing? So as you will see, what was the most important things? The guest list, the budget, the photographer details, emails, your venue location, any design decor ideas, my inventory list, again, photography stuff, things for your ceremony, roles and responsibilities. Those are the real important nitty-gritty things that you might forget. very important stuff in the wedding binder. Here was my receipt binder. So this binder has, and of course I threw things in at the very end because, I mean, once it's over, it's over. When I did the bachelor and bachelorette party cards, like the invites, I got them from Zazzle.com. These were the invitations. I did a bachelor party announcement and then the slot machine bachelorette party in Vegas. They're done by different designers, but you can get them on, like I said, Zazzle.com. So that gives you a great idea. This is what the prices look at. $25 was $25, $30 was $30. So about $1 per invite. Very great. And they're really cute. So, yeah. And then, oh, let's see here. There you go, guys. If you want to use this coupon code, and I will try to have that below, but I mean, I'm giving you enough time to check it out. 15% off of your next order. Use that code below. So I'll give you guys that code right there. So check out that code and use it for 15% off. It's probably going to be first come, first serve, but whoever gets it first, you're going to get 15% off. The next tab was our wedding guide for our location. So most places, if you're going out of town or even if you're in town, if you're at a hotel or whatnot, they should have a guide. So of course, they're going to hype the resort. This just talks about the spaces and the functionality of the rooms and what you get when you rent. The event policies, so your different tasting, your bar options, etc. Cleanup of things, the hours, you know, your deposit and final payment, how that all works, the wedding cake info, music info, your seating chart and place cards. Like, every detail on here is very important and useful. They've done it many times. Some of these places will have a wedding coordinator or an event coordinator. In our case, we did. She helped with a lot of the stuff, so that was great. Room feature, so booking a bedroom, so a different accommodations, how it all works for your guests, and then the contact info for the location. Here I had cake places, so I had looked at different cake places, did my research on prices, so there it gives you an idea for pricing, reasonable pricing, I would say, the different types of shapes, etc., that you can go with. I just did a round three tier. This was just some samples. So what I did here, this was for our table cards. So I had printed off these in color. So this was just an idea. I was trying to get the idea of size. But I printed them off all in color and then put them on a background that was a sparkly gold to go with my color theme and had them as place cards on the table. And they looked awesome. Everyone loved them. Definitely, if you want to incorporate your guy's taste, this was a great way to do it. And I know he loved it. So he got to feel kind of a part of it, a part of the planning. So that's pretty much the gist of that. This was just, again, like I said, housed receipts. All right, now the infamous cupcake book. So overall, what I can tell you about the wedding planning process is have your own binders with the stuff that you know is important. Utilize workbooks so that you can actually see, are you missing anything in detail? There's lots of things online for you to print off so that you know if you're on track with things, if you're forgetting things. I would say the most important things out of all this, it's very simple to pick your cake and book your person. It's very easy to book a DJ. That is the easiest part. The hardest part is planning your day before and your day of. So every detail from when the time you get up at 8 in the morning or earlier, for me it was 5 a.m., from 5 a.m. till 2 a.m. in the morning, that whole wedding day, every detail, minute by minute. That is the most important thing, because that, if you have that and you give it to others, it keeps you on the schedule. And honestly, the schedule is the most important thing. So I'm going to take you into this quick little cupcake notebook. This is where I had told you I housed basically any jotting of notes, any ideas, etc. It has a great little place for pockets. So basically I was planning on budgets and what I should do. Yes. Okay. So in the first part here, I planned, when do we want to go to Canmore to look at venues? So we did that 1 year before. Return on investment. Basically what this was the most important things for a wedding. So cake, is that important to me, or is it minimal? So for me, it was somewhat important. I wanted a pretty cake. Your location is important. Any rentals, the DJ, your food, your dress, are you having a videographer or a photographer? Those were the most important things. Literally just jotting down anything I possibly could. Yeah, so what I did, as I had showed you guys, is like basically I had took these books. I wrote everything in here that I was doing for jotting of notes. And then I literally transcribed from this book, reorganized it to what I was actually choosing into my hard book that I had showed you guys at the beginning of the video. And that's what I used to kind of keep everything organized that I had picked. So I just kind of used this as my jotting notes book, I guess, and kind of went from there.
Thanks for watching, guys. Take care.